McNulty, and you're listening to the Movie Guys.
Attention. The Movie Guys love movies. Any comments about an actor from Seventh Heaven making a touching kids movie instead of a touching kids movie are purely for entertainment purposes only. Isn't that right, Stephen Collins? And this is the same week that we're doing that Disney kids movie with Adam Carell.
In all fairness, I don't know if he documented his exploits.
Who?
Stephen Collins.
No, it's just a funnier joke that way.
Yeah.
He admitted it, right? Well, I see what you mean.
Yeah. Oh, the wife actually recorded him admitting it.
In his therapy session.
Yeah.
I thought we were in a safe place.
You would
I
think.
Thought the nest of security. No? Yeah. The secrecy nest?
No, if you're okay. On the couch and you've been diddling kids.
Any diddle?
No security.
Yeah.
Yeah, because even but even a psychiatrist can't bring up something illegal that happened if it's in this sacred
what
circle
is the,
of trust. No,
I don't know. Can they go to the authorities?
Adam, tell us in your experiences.
Yes,
well,
of all the many therapy sessions and of
any
all the-
actor from Star Trek One is just somewhat guilty.
I knew he was in one of those. Is it Star Trek One?
Yeah, Star Trek
we had
One.
To bring it back around to movies.
He's the new white guy in Star Trek One.
He's the only other white guy. Yeah, who, like
he's the new addition to the cast.
To death.
But he's Mr.
Not
Squeaky
a bald
Clean,
female.
Right? Seventh Heaven was.
They played
like
a
family.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean the cast is, right?
Hey, Wilford Brimley never did this.
Mm. You're Michael
God
Landon?
Damn right he
God
didn't.
Damn right.
Wilford Brimley would never betray our trust
touch
like that.
Touch his butthole.
Touch your butthole and touch
touch
it off. And
don't
there's
touch
no
your
reason not to.
Well, with Touch Your Butthole, welcome to the Movie Showcast, everybody.
Hashtag Touch Your Butthole.
Part of the vast and sprawling Movie Guys empire. And don't forget, a man may be the head of the house, but a woman is the neck, and she can turn the head any way she wants. You've reached ground zero for all things movies and comedy. We bring the two together right here on our show every week with jokes, rants, sketches, characters, bits, special guests, and more as we broadcast from the Admiral's Club in beautiful downtown Burbank. They don't stop making movies, so we don't stop making comedy shows about movies, which means you can get a new show from us every week. Basically, search the internets and Googles, and we come right up. iTunes, SoundCloud, YouTube, Stitcher, and of course, themovieguys.net, absolutely free. And we encourage you to subscribe where you can, and if you do, still... no charge. Speaking of themovieguys.net, newly posted to the site is a review from our indie film critic, Justin Bowler, covering motivational growth.
Which is actually the story of his chest. Have you seen his Facebook photos lately?
He has bigger boobs than I do.
He does.
Not Justin? Boobs in a girly way.
Justin.
Like,
what t-shirt contest Justin?
Let's bring up personal information about one of our friends. No, but he's...
I was making a motivational
good.
Growth.
He's all
yes.
Yeah, he's
if
all
you're
muscular.
Following Justin on Facebook, you're following his gym challenge.
Yes.
Since January 1st. So,
and
yeah,
I
he's
have,
showing off that
I
chest.
Have failed the challenge. I
is,
was he, just...
is that meet as many gyms as possible? Or I missed it.
I was on the gen like challenge.
Yeah. James, I'm going to count it.
You can find showcasts like the one you're listening to on a couple of internet radio stations as well, including WBAD.net Fridays at 4 p.m. Eastern and JonasMountRadio.com Thursdays at 6 Eastern, who last I looked were also... not charging.
Wow.
I'm your host for the hardest working podcast on the airwaves, Paul Preston, here with Lee Caius, Adam Witt, and Karen Volpe. And later in the show, we'll be joined by actress and star of a new horror film, Dawn of the Crescent Moon, Tracey Birdsall.
Yay, Tracey Birdsall.
And bringing a guest. We'll get into that later.
Can guests bring guests?
Guests can bring guests.
Wow.
Unprecedented. Very exciting.
What other show has guests that bring guests?
None, I say.
Yeah.
It's all they can do just to get the first guest.
That's right.
Well, we always have a very special guest here. The cricket.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Son of a bitch
Though,
is back.
I learned from the guest of the guest that we need to get a cat in here.
Yeah.
For the guest of the guest's cat
should be here.
I think you got to go back to Johnny Carson to have guests that brought guests. Didn't, who would come on? Like,
Bert would always bring Dom.
Dom DeLuise.
Right, yeah. I don't think Dom was ever invited to a show.
Well, we'd be joined later by Tracy's Dom DeLuise. So it's kind of exciting.
And if you close your eyes, they look exactly alike.
Yeah, if you don't, yeah.
They
actually,
don't
ladies,
know.
You'll want to tune in.
So right. Let's see. This show will bring you some movie reviews. A little what did you see this week? We'll play that later. Karen's birthdays. And we'll dip into the Hollywood Reporter to look at upcoming horror film origin stories.
Right.
So that's bound to be stupid. And of course, as we do every show, we're bringing you our patented movie previews. Three films to discuss this week, including the origin story of one of the great heroes of cinema and literature, Dracula. Wait, what? Okay, now I'm curious. It's Dracula Untold. Also, Robert Downey Jr. and Robert Duvall in The Judge.
Here come the judge! Here come the judge! Here come the judge! Here come the judge!
and Alexander.
No one was alive when that used to be on.
Back when comedy wasn't that hard.
Really? That was not working at all.
No.
No work involved in that.
All those people left.
We were talking about it 30 years ago.
You know, I wanted to try and find a drop of the judge from Hee Haw. Remember they always had that judge thing? Yeah. And I couldn't remember if you had a catchphrase or whatever. Talk about the phoning it in show, man. Hee Haw. Holy crap. But to be fair, I watched Hee Haw clips for an hour.
I would watch laughing for an hour. You give me an hour.
You were just waiting for the girls to pop out of the corn.
Salute!
All right. Doom, despair, and agony on me.
Good. Clearly, we never saw an episode.
No,
never seen it. Or Sean, no.
Never followed the Newlywed Game when I was growing up. Not at all. And what else was there in the movie? There's another movie. Oh, Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day.
For Alexander, life couldn't get worse. For his family, life couldn't be better. But one day can change everything.
Or what I like to call Alexander and the... when does Foxcatcher come out? Because that's the Steve Carell movie I really
watch. Oh, okay. Foxcatcher.
Oh, right, the wrestling one, where he's a wrestling coach.
Yeah, which is like killing at festivals.
That's going to be cool.
With Channing Tatum and Mark Ruffalo. Hmm. Yeah, it's the new Bennett Miller film. The guy made Moneyball and Capote. Looks fantastic.
I just pictured Channing Tatum in a singlet. Right?
You'll be wearing one.
Singlet.
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 Right? That's good.
Now, is this the first wrestling movie since Vision Quest? I do believe it is.
The wrestler.
Win-win was
a wrestler, but that's a little different.
Paul Giamatti. And what? The wrestler.
Few
and far between.
But this isn't big time wrestling. This is wrestling.
Right? This is wrestling?
I know of only two.
It is, yeah.
I know of only two wrestling movies outside of big time wrestling. Vision Quest with
Linda
Matthew McConaughey.
Matthew Modine.
Modine.
I'm like, what?
McConaughey.
And the guy who played Jake in 16 Candles. Was also in Vision Quest.
He was only in like two movies.
Only two movies.
They moved to Wisconsin to like do woodworking or something.
Yep, he's a carpenter.
No shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then the only other wrestling movie was one with, who was the best man that we ran into in that bar?
The best man?
Lorenzo Lamas' best man.
Oh,
we ran into there was another movie with Lorenzo Lamas. And that was a wrestling. That was the only two like high school wrestling movies I've ever seen.
By the way, I would like to say this is the first time hearing of the Foxcatcher. So for the rest of the show, if we impart no new information or usable information, we've done something tonight.
Exactly. In fact, we may have already talked more about that than Alexander and the whatever the fuck.
Fine.
Deservedly so.
All right, let's get on to our movies. In our first film, Dracula gets the 300 treatment with plenty of exploding wood and slow-mo shots of sword fighting. Unfortunately, this time, all the men seem to be wearing shirts. Sorry, Karen.
Yeah, there's a lot you really should be sorry for in that sentence.
It's Dracula Untold. Adam?
Exploding wood. Now, that's the porn parody.
Yeah, that's right.
300, right?
The true origin story, exploding wood.
With Dracula Untold, we have the perfect October date movie.
Take my word for it. If you want to make out with a young lady, take her to see Dracula.
Yes, Dracula has clearly hired the same publicist as The Terminator, Maleficent, The Wicked Witch of the West, and The Wicked Witch of the West, as this retelling of this horror icon tells us all the very good and positive reasons he drank the blood of thousands he murdered.
Unlike Bela Lugosi...
Well, I thought he was dead.
No, he's very much alive.
Dracula Origins, Genesis, The Beginning, gives us insight to what Dracula, played here by fake Orlando Bloom Luke Evans... was really like, and what obsessions drove him. Here's a clip.
How do you do? It is I, the Count. They call me the Count because I love to count things. I was just playing my beautiful
organ. It would be more exciting.
Listen to the lovely notes.
It's more informative than I thought it would be.
Beautiful.
Right, that might not have been from the movie. Yeah.
In the movie, we go way back to Dracula's beginning and find out new facts and old secrets that finally see the light of day, so to speak. For example, Vlad the Impaler got his nickname for his sexual prowess.
I don't give a shit where the stuff I love comes from. I just love the stuff I love.
Are you sure, Patton Oswalt? Because this movie tells you all about how the world's most famous vampire came into being, how he was a good, honest, and decent, and wanted to protect his family.
Hey, do you like Angelina Jolie? Does she give you a big boner? Well, here's John Voight's ball sack.
Fair enough.
Oh, my God. Wood joke and a boner joke within like 5 seconds.
And a ball sack just for a cherry.
That's the movie, guys.
When a sultan takes 1,000 children from Transylvania for his army, including the son of Prince Vlad Tepes?
Correct. Ding.
The prince makes a bargain with some local Nosferatus to give him superhuman powers to go to war with the sultan's forces. Now, what would you pay for all this power?
Jeez, I don't know, Paul.
I know what you're thinking. $100? $200?
Sure.
No. You can get all this power and the ability to turn into a flock of bats for the low, low price of your eternal soul, an insatiable thirst for human blood, and no trips to the beach.
Hey, yay, that's brilliant.
Sign me up.
I want one of those.
Should I order now or people standing by?
$19.99.
Flying by. Unlike recent revisionist vampires where they do everything including eat garlic bread and go to church, Dracula Untold goes full vampire, including the one thing no vampire movie does anymore, which is turn into a bat.
Oh.
Making this the original Batman Begins.
Hey now.
But besides that goof title, this story of Dracula fighting against all odds to retain his kingdom and family did undergo many different titles during production, including Dracula Year One, which producers felt audiences might mistake for the sequel to Vampire Academy. And naturally, Dracula and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Immortality.
Although the trailer doesn't mention it, I assume he can still be killed with a stake to the heart, because that kills everything.
I have to say, though, if one of the downsides of ultimate power is no war during daylight, it may not be the shortcut to domination you're looking for.
The sequel's already greenlit, Paul, with no story or script, so they're calling it Dracula Untitled.
There you go. Look for that. Probably next year if we know how The Conjuring works. Crank out another sequel.
I love all this rebooting and revisioning and, you know, a new Dracula and doing, I mean, this does like all kinds of crazy fun stuff. It takes, you know, it takes part of like the opening to, you know, Bram Stoker's Dracula and then sort of merges it with 300 or something. And
I mean, it did have a lot of
giant armies,
300-ness about it.
Yeah.
Like huge computer generated shots of massive armies and sword fighting. And
can't have 100 guys versus 100 guys anymore.
Yeah.
It's got to be like 100,000 versus 100,000.
Yeah. Is it going to be weird for you though, Paul? Because I know that you don't like bats, and you have this weird, like, jerky thing.
I know for a fact they're going to land in my hair.
I know, and that's why when I was watching the preview, at one point they just started coming from everywhere. And if you saw that in the theater,
yeah, maybe I shouldn't go to like.
How
a
many
real
times
good,
has this happened to you, Paul?
I should wait. Never.
Never.
But it will. That's
never.
Because I'm on guard.
Oh, that's right.
He's vigilant.
That's why I need to go to the Valley Plaza 6. If I, you know, won't be so realistic then. I'll be like, this is a shit production. Exactly. Or shit projection.
People will be screaming, get him! Get him, Dracula!
Yeah. I mean, I won't be worried about the... Yeah, I'll be still wanting to shush everybody. I won't be concerned with the bats.
Who brought 12 5-year-olds to Dracula Untold?
Offensive to me is this. This is from the trailer.
Welcome to your life.
What is it you are seeking?
I want the power to destroy my enemies and save my family.
There's no turning back.
Leave
back.
Tears for Fears alone. What'd they ever do to you, movie?
Question in the back.
Yes.
Is that Lourdes?
Oh, I don't know.
It's everyone doing Lourdes now. This is the way to sing now. Fake vowels. You know, no one talks like this, but hey, when it's time to sing, suddenly I wrong.
And we went from women grunting and groaning. That song.
That was an amazing,
right?
Britney
now
impersonation.
It's change the way you say your vowels.
Clearly, they did not have Mary Charbonnet's stage voice class.
Everything is annoying.
Clearly,
you know?
No. Yeah,
that's a lot of vowels in that name.
Lee, that is a solid point. Maybe we'll call that the show.
I said everything is annoying me now.
Grandpa.
That's why you're here. You're here because you don't like movies or because it means people.
He doesn't like movies.
I don't like going out.
Like going out. Yeah. No,
I love
theaters.
Movies if I didn't have to go to the theater.
Yeah.
I don't like it when they have these previews and the blowing.
But in the middle of that, you heard Charles dance.
We
good,
did.
Great actor Charles dance.
What is it you see?
Oh, yeah.
This is full on. The Gravitas casting company put this group of
he's
actors
he's the villain
together.
From The Golden Child, correct?
Oh, I love that.
You may be right. He's the villain from Last Action Hero.
Last Action Hero is the only really good thing about Last Action Hero.
Game of Thrones
I want
right
the
now.
Bass.
Yeah, exactly.
I want the bass.
Yeah, and it's all, this movie is, there's going to be no,
Golden
I
Child.
Predict, there's no humor in this movie. It is just going to be.
There may not be epically. Intentionally humor in this movie.
Well, yes.
That's true. I do like that. I love that. I mean, you got me at the moment of the trailer. Like, he turns to the camera and smiles and then just runs off the cliff and turns into a giant flock of bats.
Yeah.
Not just one.
You're right. That is
flock.
A flock.
That is missing from the
No, yeah, nobody. Right. Nobody in Twilight turns into bats. Nobody turns into bats anymore. Yeah. The last one is probably Bram Stoker's Dracula. He turned into a giant.
Yeah,
he's been
for 20 years.
He used to be able to turn into mist as well. Maybe he can do that.
And Flock of Bats is another '80s band. I hope they leave alone. I hope they don't screw a Flock of Bats up. Because
all right, listen, according to the movies, no one can be just plain evil anymore, right? This is what we're learning from Dracula. Yeah. Until we have to go back to their childhood and find out why. What bad upbringing, wrongdoing, or lost love made them become the lunatic they grew up to eventually become? Regardless of how Dracula Untold does, Maleficent has already made over $750 million worldwide. So a number of backstory films have been greenlit. And they're listed in the most recent Hollywood Reporter. Do you guys have that?
The most recent one?
Just copy of the magazine.
I have the most recent one right here.
I have the exact same one you guys do.
Do you have the most recent one, Adam?
Yeah, right here. Clearly. Right here it says.
These are all the most recent, yet they have different covers.
Well...
It's niche marketing.
Only if you're watching on YouTube.
Now, these are
they sound the same.
These are movies. Greenlit, they're going back to discover the backstory of some famous villains. Let's see what we have here. For example, opening next year, after four Jaws movies, we're finally going to get the backstory of the famous great white shark.
I've been wanting to know this.
Right. Well, turns out Jaws got a bad taste for humans in Jaws' baby teeth. Detailing Jaws' time as a lowly sleight of hand artist in the Pacific Ocean.
After an
encounter with Japanese fishermen, Jaws not only flees to New England but gains empathy from the audience.
Hmm.
The encounter with the Japanese fisherman took its toll as he ends up with a damaged fin. But soon the story takes a heartwarming miracle worker turn when he meets Ashley Judd and Harry Connick Jr. who give him artificial flippers to continue his sleight of hand magic because he loves doing it so much.
Paul, look right here.
Yes, so the nodding. Knowing Karen's giving me the knowing Ashley Judd nod.
That was a dead-on impersonation of Ashley Judd. Smiling,
you do a very
nod.
Good Ashley Judd nodding.
Sadly, his first sleight of hand show at Amity Beach, which has a lot of interaction, the show confuses swimmers, and Jaws is mistaken for a cold-blooded killer.
And that's where the next movie picks up.
Yeah, well, it's gonna be hard to do the sleight of hand with fins. People think you're trying to kill.
So he uses his mouth, and then the teeth, that's the problem.
That's too bad.
Yep.
Hey Lee, check this out.
What page are you on Hollywood Reporter?
I'm on page. Two.
Oh, ooh, me too. Okay.
They get right to it.
It's a big story.
I see here that Jeffrey Dahmer will be getting a reboot.
Oh, really?
As a misunderstood hero in the fall release of To Serve Man, which tells the story of a young Jeffrey Dahmer so moved by the cause of health and dietary purity that he fought against the agricultural damage caused by vegetarians by going humanitarian.
Wait.
How considerate.
And creating a diet entirely of teenage boys. His intentions are misunderstood by the local police, who put our hero in prison, leaving his diet book, A Sociopath's Guide to Dining at Gay Bars, unpublished.
When you think he's an evil bastard.
I know, right? You get this other turn.
There's
some twist on
always another side to the story. There's always more to it than you think. For example.
Tell us.
Here's another synopsis. I think we'll all find very interesting.
I look forward to hearing it, Lee.
All little Adolf wanted was to play softball with his friends.
Yeah.
But what happens when a young man's dreams of building team spirit in his community turns into a nightmare? Only World War II, that's what happens. After getting the local SS shop, Schulte's Sporting Goods, to be exact, to sponsor the entire league, Adolf thought his plan for societal harmony was falling into place. Until one fateful day when a gas leak in the showers of the local gymnasium where they practiced led to tragic consequences. This fall, look forward to a blitzkrieg of their own.
So Hitler, I assume.
Is there crying in Blitzkrieg?
There's a lot of crying in a Blitzkrieg of their own.
Okay.
Schultzy.
And finally, I'm just looking here in my Hollywood Reporter, which is all about watches. So that's very exciting.
The watch edition.
I have the watch edition. But it's the most recent watch edition.
Yeah.
It says, finally, the news of the all-female Ghostbusters, which was announced today.
True.
Wait.
Yes.
It's a go.
Yeah.
It's a go.
All-female Ghostbusters, Paul Feig is going to be
writing it. How did real news end up
finally
on our fake Hollywood Reporter?
I didn't mean for that to happen.
I got confused for a minute. I thought we were reading the fake Hollywood Reporter.
Well, we accidentally slipped that in there.
Fake Hollywood Reporter. All right, so oxymoron.
We have the news of an all-girls Ghostbusters. Report. It's going forward. So soon after that, we'll see a whole film detailing the backstory of Mr. Stay Puft. More than just a creepy apparition, Mr. Stay Puft started out as Petty Officer Third Class Stay Puft, a chubby naval recruit with a penchant for floating along distances, making him an asset in espionage maneuvers. He also liked docking in city ports and making it with the ladies.
If I know what I mean.
Right? Until one day, he found the woman of his dreams, Ms. Fluffernutter, But before he could pledge his love to her, an unfortunate encounter with Gozer by campfire launches him into a life of mob-style hits on buildings. Or steps on buildings, whichever you'd like. All this and more mob in steps. How to Be Mellow.
Well, there you go. That's.
Well, I want to see.
I promised it'd be stupid. It
Fluffernutter is a very sexy sounding sandwich. I never really thought about that till just
and
now.
And why is there not a porn star called Stacey Fluffernutter? Or
it will be now. Patent pending.
Patent pending. Carrie Fluffernutter. Fluffy Nutter. Where's Fluffy Nutter?
So what you're saying, Paul, is that they're revising all these villains.
Yes.
You know what's fun is you don't really think of Mr. Stay Puffed as a villain, but he's the bad guy. Him and Dickless.
In our next film, finally, the true story of the life of Judge Reinhold comes to the big screen in The Judge.
Actually, Paul, you're confusing this movie with the November release, The Reinhold.
Oh, let me see here for a second. Oh, yes. I see. For our next film, Robert Downey Jr. trades in his superhero armor for emotional armor in The Judge. Here we go. This is a serious movie about serious people doing serious things, but you don't have to take our word for it. The movie will tell you itself.
Dad cannot go to prison. You cannot lose this case.
I know the music will tell you as well.
In the film, Downey plays Hank Palmer, a successful metropolitan attorney who returns to his hometown of Carlinville, Indiana.
Sounds hilarious.
Uh-huh. When his mother passes away.
I was wrong.
There he's forced to not only confront the past he thought he'd left behind him, but he also has to remove his Obama bumper sticker.
The funeral reconnects Hank with his estranged father, Joe, a local judge played by Robert Duvall. You can tell they're related because they share the family name, Robert. Their relationship has grown distant over after they became Facebook friends, revealing to Joe his son's stance on Obamacare.
The father and son's relationship is tested as Joe is accused of murder, and Hank is called on to represent his father in court. I'm sure Duvall looks guilty because he's probably killing it in this role.
Zing.
Right.
It's funny because it's true.
Right. Fitting that Robert Duvall should play a judge because every time he's on screen, it's like he's holding court. Giving a lesson on acting.
They keep coming.
The thorn in his side is the prosecuting attorney played by Billy Bob Thornton wearing his courtroom hair. He really wants to see Joe Fry. Lest you think there's any good to this character, he is named Dwight Dickum.
Everything was fine with our system until the power grid was shut off by Dickless here.
No doubt from the law firm of Dewey, Dickum, and Howe.
And Vera Farmiga plays a local who's so smart and sexy, it begs the question, why is she still in this small town?
Baggage. Yeah. The film also stars friend of the movie Showcast, David Krumholz, who was a guest on our show in May. Looks like the movie guy's bump is still working. So there you go. You got that to look forward to, Tracey.
It's Vera Farmiga, right?
Farmiga.
For the record, both guest and guest of guest laughed at courtroom hair. So clearly,
people know about the hair.
It's a sensibility that we all have. We already know what that means.
Yeah.
So he especially is a proud involver. Is that the word?
Of his hair?
User? He takes part in your theory.
Yes.
Billy Bob, whatever movie, what hair do I need?
The time is right for my occasional hair.
Oh, yeah. God. I saw on the train the other day and I thought of you.
It's so wonderful
in Hollywood that occasionally you'll just, there'll be just James Brown across from you on the train because he's coming from some, you know? And it was just James Brown sitting on the train, just completely James Browned out with the James Brown hair and the James Brown suit. I saw Elvis like this on a bus. I have a great picture of just an entire bus of just really sad people and then just Elvis at the very center of the bus. That's Hollywood, right? You've got to get a James Brown wig. This was the wig I want to see you just show up and have everyone say whatever they want, but the more times you just show up with your James Brown hair, that's just Bart's hair.
He's wearing jeans today. Oh, he's wearing his James Brown hair.
But on a black guy, it's James Brown. On a white guy, you could be Yahoo Serious if you're not careful.
I would like to think more Michael Landon.
Ooh, get your Michael Landon hair.
Michael Landon always looked like he was getting ready to film a werewolf movie.
And it's no fair. A guy like Michael Landon goes into a barbershop, they charge him $6. I go in, they charge me $6. He's got like way more hair.
He's got a lot more hair.
Isn't the Lonely Guys Club? Steve Martin.
Oh, yeah.
Lonely Guy Club.
Oh, is that in there?
Yeah, it's in
there. I was going to give you a lot of credit for that. Yeah.
And
you.
I referenced Yahoo Serious. Anyone else want to get in on the 80s references? From
That's not a knife.
Oh, sure, pick the popular one.
Shoot, I have to think of one.
I couldn't go obscure enough.
I'm excited. I think Billy Bob actually is one of the great actors we have. And both he and Duvall look to be in good roles in this.
Don't you think?
Was a time when Billy Bob was in A Simple Plan, The Man Who Wasn't There, and Monsters Ball, all back to back to back.
Then he started
three
a band.
Great movies. And then he started a band.
Then
and
he started went a band. Yeah. He went Tina Yothers on us.
Yeah. What I like about him, I think this movie is a great reminder that he is a really good actor. But what I think I know about him is that the whole reason he did Sling Blade is because he wanted to be an actor, not because he wanted to make movies.
Yeah, right. It was kind of the Goodwill Hunting thing. Like,
right, yeah.
I'll write something myself.
Rocky.
Yeah. But with the objective of being an actor, not a filmmaker.
Yeah.
I think that's pretty.
Yeah, he's only directed one or two times since then. Right?
Yeah.
But yeah, he's excellent. So, and then Duvall as well plays so many supporting characters nowadays, but this looks like a big meaty role, and you know what? He's going to be great.
Oh,
because
yeah.
When you give him the big meaty role, like in Get Low, with mm-hmm. one with Bill Murray recently, he just nails it, because he's going to nail whatever size the role is. It's up to Hollywood to give an 81-year-old guy a decent role, and it looks like they do here.
I know that RDJ produced this with his wife, and I found it funny. There was a tweet that went out, and it said, go to see The Judge. It was from RDJ, and he said, go see The Judge so that people will want to see movies with people in them again, something like that. So the audiences will go see movies about people. And it was the idea that it's a relationship movie, and Paul brought up this point. He goes, that's coming from Iron Man.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was like, oh, shoot.
So that's both kind of, whatever. But it also means, it's coming from Iron Man. So even he's saying, there's room for everything.
Wait
so
a minute, are you suggesting nothing splodes in this movie?
I think that's what he was trying to say. Just a little bit of wood. Other than that,
no
nothing
splodes.
Else.
Exploded.
Karen's wood will explode.
No splodes.
Right?
She's all over the Robert
wait.
Downey Jr.
This is a very exciting week. On Saturday, I'm going to go see RDJ. And then I think tomorrow, Bill Murray's movie is opening.
Yeah, we're going to cover St. Vincent in a couple of weeks.
Crazy.
But that's when it opens nationally. It turns out opens in LA this weekend.
So close.
That's why we live here.
Yeah.
All right, well listen, does everything work out in the end of The Judge? Tough to tell, but we learn a little bit about what's going on, and will these characters learn about life, love, and family? We'll learn about that a little bit from the trailer. Let me play this for you and you'll see.
I'll paint your father as a holier-than-thou prick determined to see what he considers justice served.
My father is a holier-than-thou prick determined to see what he considers justice served, so it's going to be a light day.
That's fun.
That music says clearly people are going to learn about themselves and others in this movie.
I also heard to bring tissues.
Maybe. Now, anytime a movie wraps itself up in a folksy montage of everyone enjoying their struggle.
We're done talking about exploding wood. Cut it out.
Sorry, Paul.
That's all right. When a movie
you were saying.
When a movie is characters.
Sorry, Paul. You were doing a show.
Yeah. Hey, well, you wrote something that you're actually trying to say. Pardon me.
When a movie takes time to have its characters learn about life, love, family, and happiness, we call it in the movie guysopedia, going Salisbury Hill.
Yes.
As soon as a trailer goes Salisbury Hill, you know people are going to learn something. You know, mm-hmm. things are going along, and it's kind of fun, and we're having a good time, and suddenly, you know, Dad's really sick.
Uh-oh.
It's a time of adventure.
Yeah. Look, all
of
he wants
understanding.
Is for you kids to spend 5 days in a house.
Yeah. Together?
I lost the music. Okay.
What? Oh, yeah.
I was trying to bring it in at the right time.
Look, we're all going to have to figure this out.
Together.
But now it's like this fake Mumford and Sons type of music.
Yeah, so much better than the real Mumford and Sons.
That's right. So that's what trailer's been using lately. I mean, you heard it. Let me play that clip again, and you'll hear it right at the end.
I'll paint your father as a holier-than-thou prick determined to see.
That clip's too long. But anyway, you know, at the end of it, it starts going, and let's. That seems to be a new thing. I bet it wouldn't have worked with really good dramas of the past, and that's why those trailers looked and sounded different. Let's just hear an example right here.
Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
He told me enough. He told me you killed him.
No. I am your father.
It's about a father and a
and son
and life.
Also, should have said spoiler alert there, sir.
Oh,
right?
Here's another one.
You look terrible. I should eat. I want you to rest well, and a month from now, this Hollywood big shot's gonna give you what you want.
Too late. They start shooting in a week.
I'm gonna make him an offer he can't refuse.
I actually really like that one.
It's about a family.
The first, The first three words you can't understand without context of the movie. I had no idea. Blah, blah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, it's a
little could have been from Rocky. Right?
Could, I thought.
It could have been Arnold.
Yeah, this one. Oh, speaking of which.
Uh-oh. I'll be back.
It's about a boy and a machine.
All right. Well, let's see. We've had something.
Just like life.
Well, let's see. We've had something for Adam, something for Karen. Sorry, Lee. We're shit out of luck because our final film is for somebody, but it's not anybody in this room.
Thank God.
We are not the demographic for Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day. But we're stuck talking about it anyway. Lee, here we go.
Maybe you could put on your kid hair, Lee.
Oh! Put on your moppy kid hair. Kids only have moppy hair in movies, right?
I want to look must or tussled.
You should look tussled.
Hey, remember the TV show Malcolm in the Middle? Well, Hollywood hopes you don't.
The classic children's book Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day comes to the big screen, to the annoyance of people that put the letters on movie theater marquees everywhere.
Much like the book, the movie presents event after event in the worst day of a child's life. I haven't read the book, but I assume he wakes up to find both parents killed by a drone, lives off food from dumpsters until he's sold into sex slavery. That sounds like a terrible day. Or maybe they should call this Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad First World Day.
Alexander and the Horrible, Shitty, Awful, Stupid, Fuck-Faced, Dickhead, Asshole, Jerk-Off Day stars Steve Carell, star of the most popular TV show since Seinfeld, Horton Hears a Who, Date Night, Despicable Me, Get Smart, Evan Almighty, and dozens of widely popular mainstream projects befitting a star of his caliber. And yet, one look at this makes me scream, sell out!
Right. Alexander in the gruesome, infected, hideous, sickening, no good, very bad genocide also stars Jennifer Garner, who seems to be taking it easy. But the real person you have to look at for 2 hours is Alexander, played by Ed Oxenbould, whose lisp is annoying and too full of spit to be cute after he speaks his first line in the trailer. Here's a clip.
Suffering fucking
pretty sure that's him. Also, he might be a midget or growth-stunted adult presented as a kid, and that never goes down easy with me.
If her sons aren't causing disasters left and right, then they're growing leaves from their legs in the odd life of Timothy Green. Is Hollywood telling us that Jennifer Garner shouldn't be allowed to procreate? Keep her away from that Juno kid, that's all I'm saying.
Right?
This trailer has two distinct halves. The first half seems to suggest that this movie is about a kid having a bad day. Mm-hmm. The second part seems to be about his father having a bad day. It's as if the filmmakers knew that 15 seconds into the trailer they're going to lose any potential audience member under 8 years of age. But that's also right about when mom and dad will look up and say, hey look, Steve Carell has another movie up. Now, which kind is it? A zany, wacky kid movie or a Steve Carell vehicle? Well, that's for you to decide because clearly the movie can't.
Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day, because the original title, Wackiness Ensues, didn't test well with 8 to 12-year-olds.
There you go. Surprise. I'd love to be at that test, by the way, with the 8 to 12-year-olds.
They didn't know what just ensues push. Meant.
That's right.
Ensues.
Now, whenever you see something you like in the trailer, just push the eat. Not yet. I mean, a lot of that probably goes
they
on.
They just like pressing the button.
Eat, kids.
And at the end of that test, they're all covered with jelly. All the buttons are just sticky. That's why they don't test on kids anymore. They're clogging up the dials here.
Right. And the cell phone guys come in for their focus group. It's like, what the?
I think you're right. Even if kids don't have anything on them that's sticky,
it just comes out of them. Why do you have jelly on you? There isn't jelly within a mile of here. Where did you get a peanut butter sandwich?
Where is their paste for them to eat? I haven't seen paste in like 30 years. They got it and they're eating it.
Oh my goodness.
Should I give my kid a lisp if I... We're not going to have a kid.
Oh, I used to have a lisp.
Yeah, but why didn't you keep
was
it?
Was it cute?
You should have worked in. You could have worked in the movies. I should have worked in.
I've used it before. I use it when I do a little shop. I bring it right back. And well, then I talk like this, and it's very easy to do.
You know, well, what you do is you just smack him right before each take. You just
right.
Pop him in the chops.
Then he has a lisp or he doesn't?
He does.
Oh,
and then,
yeah.
That way you don't have to get any permanent dental work done.
Excellent.
The movie Showcast in no way endorses child abuse.
We're just trying to use a technique.
Just trying to make kids
acting.
Great like the great Santini was.
You going to cry? You going to cry now?
You going to cry? You going to cry now? You going to cry now?
This is actually probably the biggest example of a movie that makes me glad I don't have children and don't have to go to this movie.
Yes.
This looks like horrible,
right.
Horrible movie.
Like you'd go see Epic or something.
I'd see Epic. I'd see Up. I'd see Frozen.
I'd see the Box Trolls.
Yeah, I'd take my kids to Box Trolls.
I'd be
the one I'd go to.
This is exactly the movie.
Oh, who am I kidding? I take my kids to Chainsaw 3D. Work it out later.
There'll be some splaining to do, but it's eventually you're going to have to talk about that stuff anyway, right?
Work this out with a different adult when you're older.
It's your college fund or your therapy. You decide. You get to make that decision. It's your money. You decide. College or therapy.
What's interesting to note in the trailer for Alexander and the terrible title?
What is interesting?
Tell us, Paul.
How it must differ from the book.
Oh, right?
That's true. It's based on a book. That's right.
The trailer seems pretty of the moment, yet the book is from 1972.
Ah.
If anything here, we like to be educational on the show, right? So we'd like to share with you now, after extensive research, the original text so you can see what Hollywood scriptwriters go through to update material. Let me give you an example of what we're talking
about.
Please
do, Paul.
Let me play this clip from the trailer.
Once I get my license tomorrow, I kind of have everything I've ever wanted. I'm hashtag blessed, you know?
Okay, see, now in the original book, the kid didn't say hashtag blessed. They didn't have hashtags. They didn't have computers.
Yeah, hashtag was just a worthless button on the phone. It was just on there, but nobody knew what to do with it.
And they call it a pound sign.
Right.
So back in the book, if you look at the book, it's the kid said, "You won't have Dick Nixon to kick around anymore." See how that probably wouldn't have as much impact today?
Oh, I see. That's a little more 72.
I could see where it would be of that time.
And kids were a little more current with their events.
Right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, Paul, I actually did a little research myself as well on that very dynamic of the book. And so let's take a look at another moment in the trailer.
Sure.
I got a call today. I have an interview for a game design firm.
You could be looking at the new vice president of Lone Hill Press.
See, now, back then, in 1972, they didn't have any game designers, right?
No.
So that's how the dialogue was originally written. Actually, here's how it was originally written. Quote, "I have an interview with the committee to reelect the president for a job with the Democratic National Committee to break into the Watergate headquarters and steal copies of top secret documents and bug office phones."
Oh, okay.
That was the original line.
Okay, so that's more obviously more
1972. They replaced it with game designers.
Yeah, right,
game designers is probably faster.
Should I read that again? Because
it
was replaced with game designers.
It's kind of fascinating, though, Lee. I got to say that.
Thanks, Letterman.
Sold. Hey, Paul, can we dig a little bit further into the trailer,
please?
I'll
play another clip.
Yes!
Let's go, Wreck-It Ralph.
Oh, that couldn't have been in the book.
Zing. Originally, she said, "Let's go, Deep Throat."
Oh.
Because it was 1972, you see.
Oh, and that would have been topical then.
Yeah. Political bend.
Because that's a movie.
Come on, Deep Throat. Okay.
Look at that.
Well, I guess three of us have something we talked about there, so it's over?
It's got to be more.
You know, there's little kids somewhere with sticky fingers just pressing buttons going, make it stop, make it stop.
Well, that is something. Let's look at one final way they updated the film. Paul, go ahead.
I can't believe Elliot texted photoshopped pictures of me to the whole school.
Nice boobs, Alexander.
See, that Photoshop, obviously, right?
Oh, that is today's topical reference.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's great. That's there for the 2014 crowd. Smart update from the book, you know, going Photoshop. Mm-hmm. But here, I did dig up what they originally said. The book originally had the young man say, "The kids recorded me at school. I'd play you the transcript, but there's an 18 and a half minute gap in the transcription. While playing my tape, the transcriber answered a phone call. Reaching for the transcription machine stop button, she said she mistakenly hit the button next to it, which was the record button. For the duration of the phone call, about 5 minutes, she kept her foot on the device's pedal, causing a 5 minute portion of the tape to be re-recorded. When she listened to the tape, the gap had grown to 18 and a half minutes, and she later insisted that she was not responsible for the remaining 13 minutes of buzz. The contents missing from the recording remain unknown to this day." Oh, that's a reference to Watergate.
Wait,
oh,
yes.
That's
Watergate.
Yeah, and in all fairness, it was a book, so you could fill pages with words.
You know, because that painted pictures for me. Yeah.
All right, we're going to take a break here. 10, 15 seconds at most, and we'll be back with our guest
segment. We'll start joking any second.
Soon it'll get crazy.
Our guest segment features one of the stars of Dawn of the Crescent Moon, Tracey Birdsall. Hold tight. Here we go.
Let's go, Deep Throat.
Oh, I remember my mom standing on the porch calling us for dinner that way.
Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. And let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars.
Karen, is that a piccolo or a flute?
I have a flute because I have my fingers so far apart.
Exactly. Well mimed. Well mimed. Hey, welcome back, and joining us for the rest of the show is our guest this week, an actress who's appeared on the TV shows The Young and the Restless and Loving, as well as over 60 commercials.
Nice.
And now has a flourishing indie film career, most recently appearing in Dawn of the Crescent Moon, which will have a release very soon. Please welcome Tracey Birdsall.
Thank you.
And our guest has brought a guest, as we mentioned.
Awesome.
Joining her is the director of Starship Rising, a new film that is out on video on demand and DVD and Blu-ray as well. Oh, that's right, in Walmart, right?
And iTunes.
Cool. Check it out. It's the film is called Starship Rising, and the director is here, Neil Johnson. Everybody is joining us. So you probably hear in the background, we have turned up the air conditioning. We got a full house here in our sweaty garage.
Trying to keep everyone not sweaty.
Yeah, exactly. So glad to have you all here. This is great. Dawn of the Crescent Moon is a new film that stars the only other big name in it, I believe, is Barry Corbin. Who I love.
I love Barry, too. Barry Corbin and Brandon Smith, too.
Oh, who's Brandon Smith?
He plays the professor.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He's got those great monologues about... tell us the plot real quick so we know what we're talking about.
It's basically kind of like an old throwback, you know, cult classic movie. I would like to call it a horror classic. You know, lots of people die out at a lake. They're looking for a legend. They're following the story. I mean, let's make this really simple here.
And
right?
Whoops, they find it.
We're talking about it, and we're after the treasure, too. And, Barry kind of shoots us down as Cyrus. And chime in.
Yeah, and the other guy, I'm sorry, what was his name?
Brandon Smith.
He's got the task of telling all these young students about go out and search for myths.
Right?
Then they do.
Go die.
Whatever you do, don't die.
It doesn't. Yeah. Good luck, kids. And then you have the cool task of being someone who being told about this whole story about the kids going out and looking for everything by Barry. So it's all your scenes are with Barry, which I think is cool.
Except for one. I had one without Barry, and I was very sad.
Oh, sure, you stepped outside.
Super sad.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But for those of you who don't know Barry Corbin, he played Tom Hanks' boss in Nothing in Common. He was in War Games, and he was Tommy Lee Jones' dad in No Country for Old Men. Love that guy. One of the great character actors there is. No Country, if you've listened to the show, you know is my number two movie of all time, behind Raiders of the Lost Ark.
And Northern Exposure.
And he's on Northern Exposure, too.
Yeah.
The TV
right
guys
now,
brought him up, I think. It was.
Right now, he's on 3 primetime network shows. I mean,
is
the guy
really?
Just has
That's
this,
awesome.
Like, kick-ass career. I mean, it just keeps getting better and better. He's always flying somewhere. He's like, I'll be back in a week. I'm going to go do this movie. Back in 2 weeks.
That's great.
Yeah, because you said
it's
you
amazing.
Kicked off a friendship
we
with him,
get
right?
We should get him in here.
I would love that.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Yeah. Tell him to come on in.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
absolutely.
A
career.
Tell
a
him to wear his bathing suit so he'll be comfortable in the heat.
Can he be guest of a guest?
That would be
yeah. guest of a guest's guest. Yeah. There'd be no time for Nixon jokes. That guy's got so many movies. We'd have to, we'd have a lot of talking to do.
Get in your deep throat.
Oh, and when we were shooting at night, we all hung out at the bar really late because we shot really late. I have so much video of him. He'll go into all of his old roles, and he does them exactly like he's shooting them.
Oh,
so you
got
to
cool.
get this. It's amazing.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's cool. Where did you shoot that movie?
In Fayetteville, Texas, a town of like 264 people, I think.
Wow. They must have freaked out when they saw you.
They were all there. I don't think anybody slept.
No.
They were awake. They were like so excited. They were all part of it.
Something was happening. It was exciting.
Exactly.
Wow.
The town's like a little rectangle, like a bed and breakfast. Joe's Diner, which was also the bar. There was one other little store, little park in the middle. That was it.
It all gets square and rectangle the closer to the middle of the country you get.
Yeah, I really didn't know that. You know, it's like I got there. I'm like, this is it? This is all you have?
Where are you from?
Here. Burbank. I was born in Burbank.
That's why. Yes, where we're
no
all
kidding.
From, it gets very thin and there's like a mall maybe. And then you figure out where
Applebee's
is.
We all come from cold places.
Yeah. No. I live at the beach now, but I lived here until I was about 9. So
cool. Yeah. You and Tim Burton.
Born and raised.
There you go.
Well, let's play a little clip of you talking to Barry. This is
me talking to Barry.
Early in the film. Well, there's another guy in your scene too, but
to
I don't
too.
Know.
Yeah.
Do you believe in God?
I believe there are things that we can never understand.
You didn't answer the question.
Look, there are things that you can never know. You can't reason it. You can't apply science to it. You've just got to take comfort in the fact that it's there.
Knowing that there is a higher power.
Now you got it.
Of course, a higher power isn't also good.
Yeah,
the
that's the thing.
Are,
it's the script.
Yeah. Higher power's coming back to get you.
Yeah.
Yeah. So is this a sort of thing where it's like, you know, someone would say there's something mystical out there, and then there's a conversation on whether that there God exists or not, because this sort of like there's some things you can't explain. Where in horror movies that's going to kill you, but in religious studies that's because you know there's God, right?
Well, you know, it's kind of funny because it would be a plot spoiler, which I can do if you want. But I mean, Barry, you know that because at the end Barry is.
the mystical.
No, that's true. He's sort of imparting wisdom from a. From
just
a,
listening from to a that place. Clip, yes. I felt like he was imparting wisdom.
Pretty authentic, that guy.
That
right?
is such a cool voice. He's one of those people that you would think people impersonate, like Goldblum and like Bill Paxton.
Yeah,
he
that's
has
true.
That kind of voice.
Barry Corbin, he got all kind of clipped off and
yeah.
said it. Yeah.
Actually, that was pretty good.
I'll work that. We'll work on that. We'll bring that
up. That was pretty good.
Who are you working on? And I'll work on Barry Corbin.
Oh, who am I working on?
But you
I haven't been working on
Terrence
Howard.
You got to make it a little smoother.
Terrence Howard crying.
I got my Terrence Howard almost down.
And so go to dawnofthecrescentmoon.com to find out what's going to be new with that as it works its way towards release.
Yes.
Most likely VOD and that kind of thing, right?
Yeah, they won't tell me because I do a lot of interviews. So, yeah, it's coming.
Is it in
they're
festivals?
Like, you can't
now?
Talk.
It's been doing festivals. It's,
yeah, it did. And then now they're in the final stages, but they won't tell me anything. So,
does that go into like a sci-fi festival or a horror festival? Or how's that?
It played Action on Film, which we got Best Ensemble Cast in that.
Nice.
Right?
It reminded me, if I may, about we didn't see this. I don't think anyone at the table did. From the movie guys, at least, As Above, So Below, which just came out recently with the catacombs underneath Paris.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's kind of like when the terror strike shows its face in Dawn of the Crescent Moon, it all has to do with the past, your past, kind of, and things from your past coming back to haunt
like
you.
Flatliners, kind
you,
of.
Yeah.
Flatliners, thing, yeah, that yeah. kind of thing. So.
You have to deal with
yeah,
it.
Yeah, you become your own worst. You become your own villain, right? Because it's like dredging right. up your past.
Is that
like
my mom who shot herself? I mean, it's that kind of stuff. And then yeah. you got to deal with that shit.
You guys are making this very deep.
Yeah, man.
I think that was your cue.
Hey.
No. Oh, get out of here. Wait, I can't remember.
Suck a deep throat or something. Yeah.
Shoot. Sorry about that.
Well, I'll say that. But I also bring that up because.
I was waiting for that.
I also bring that up because it's important to say that I think, well, I mean, I think it is, that it's not a horribly blood splattered movie.
No.
You know, you get the terror from other means, and I think that's also always
you
more
you get the
impressive.
Terror from needing to go to therapy, just like in real life.
And it's only the second horror film I've ever done, and I never get to bleed. I never get to get hurt. How
you
sad
don't scream
is
in this
that?
One, do you? Do you scream in this one?
No.
No. Not a
no.
scream queen?
And the last one was Prophet's Game with Dennis Hopper. I was like the reporter who wove the story like in this one. So it's like really, if I'm going to do horror again, I really want to be like pulverized.
Enough bookending.
Like maybe die over and over again where I get to keep, you know, right?
That sounds like a script I've written.
Like live, die, repeat?
But that's not horror. That's not horror, but it's like my dream to like really like be ugly and get hurt and everybody else gets to die.
Get slashed up and have to have things on your face that bleed and have goo.
Why is that all these pretty women want to just get like made ugly in movies. I've never understood. Sarah Butler was in here. She's like, oh, yeah, I really want to get dirty. I want to look as good as I can for as long as I can, especially when there's millions of people watching me.
It's got to be diversity.
Get your James Brown hair.
Where's my movie hair?
Exactly. Right? Where's my murder hair? Yeah.
So, I will be in a suit every scene. Manicured.
I hear you. I'd want to be in a movie where all of a sudden they're like, make her over and make her pretty. Yes. I'd be like, let's do it.
But you're playing Eskimos. I
don't care. Who cares? Make me pretty.
Eskimos don't wear bikinis.
All right, Neil chimed in that he wrote a script. So is this something you guys are thinking about collaborating on? You guys have collaboration in the future?
Yes. Well, we actually, I've got a film coming out called Descent into the Maelstrom. It's something I wrote back in 1995. We're at draft 33.
Is that all?
Wow.
Yeah.
These are great titles. Descent into the Maelstrom.
Yes.
Crescent Moon. What is it?
Dawn of the Crescent Moon.
These are great comic book, like, you know, issue titles.
Well, my second film was Bipolar Armageddon.
And how many drafts did you have with Bipolar?
Three.
Just remember, rewriting is writing.
Yeah, that's true.
What's Thanks, the Lee. First version that Thanks, I read Lee. Of the script? Was it 32 or 31?
No, you read draft 30, I think.
Oh, okay, so at least I... And so I read this thing, and it was spectacular.
Yeah, and it's epic. Epic.
Yeah, epic. Epic.
Now, you referred to someone... dies and then they come back to life?
Well, it's giving away some plot points. Well, I was talking about
something else, though. I was talking about horror.
No, yeah.
But you jumped on that.
Well,
I didn't say that. I did not divulge any secrets. That is not me. Do not.
By consequence, in the film, her character may or may not die at least three times.
But that was purely coincidental on what I was talking about, because I've always wanted to be pulverized and murdered.
There you go.
Oh, I could torture you if you want.
Okay, she means
it's getting a little late, guys.
Not like after the show.
By the way, we haven't introduced Neil as a filmmaker.
Yeah, we did. Oh, yeah.
He's
did we say
of the
that
friend.
He's a filmmaker? Okay.
Yeah. So let's jump to that. Tell us about Starship Rising.
Starship Rising. Okay, I think it's my 10th feature film.
That's amazing.
Yeah,
it's so hard to make a feature film.
It's amazing.
Oh, it gets harder and harder because it's all technology and stuff, you know. So,
yeah, I'm 40 pages into my script right now, and now I know there have to be like 30 rewrites. You got me all psyched.
I don't always do that. It's as technology,
and then you got to make it.
And then it changes again. But see, as technology changes, the script changes, for me at least, because, you know, it's like, oh, now I can do this. Now I can blow up a planet. That's easy. Yes, I can blow up Los Angeles. Yes, I can blow up London. I've done all these things. So I can write it in there. I can say I want to do this. And now I can kind of dream it and do it. So that's why I do the rewrites at the moment. You know, we're going to shoot Descent in the Maelstrom in 4K. It's going to be finished in 4K. We're going to do a lot of stuff. And, you know, it's, I don't know, going back with Starship, it was, I bit off more than I could chew. And it took me about a year to finish the film, which is, you know, maybe not the best thing to do because, you know, you got to get the movie released. And I live off my movies. And it's, have you ever seen the movie Dune at all? Anyone seen Dune?
Yeah, we were talking earlier. I have, that puts me in movie jail. I have not seen that.
You need to watch
but
Dune.
Adam has, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, it's kind of like, I guess it's like Star Wars crossed with Dune. And it's a big epic story. And that's all I can say. It's kind of like Game of Thrones in outer space. That's really the best description. It's the sort of movie you watch once, you go, huh? You watch twice, you go, hmm? And the third or fourth time, you start to get it. And that's what I like. That's what happens with all my films. Like Humanity's End is a movie I did in 2007. And when it came out, we got really bad reviews. But as time goes through, like we got 2 out of 10 on IMDb. And that, like now it's 4 out of 10. People watch it a second time, a third time. They say, oh, there's something to this. And that's kind of what I like with my films, and I like to be like a thinking man science fiction filmmaker. I mean, most people call me crap, and that's fine, but my crap sticks around for a long time. It sticks on the wall.
It's good crap.
Yeah.
It's impressive. We just watched the trailer for Starship. I'm sorry, I'm going to get
Starship
it wrong.
Rising.
Starship Rising. And it looks like... I mean, this looks like a real movie, like with like lots of special effects and fully realized planets and ships and people on bridges and things exploding and planets and other planets and other planets. It's crazy.
Well, it's got all. I got to tell you something that happened. When I finished the film, we were doing the cutting. They started doing the trailer. A friend of mine, he said he watched the movie and he said, "Your spaceship looks like a big black penis."
It does.
And I looked at it. And I said, he's right. I mean, it's when you look at it, I mean, people go and Google this. It is, seriously. I didn't mean for that to happen. And it's Starship Rising. So it's, ah, ha, ha, you know. So that's kind of, and then the catch
like,
cry of the movie is ramming speed. So it's
the Boubet sisters would love
so you can now get a t-shirt. You can get a t-shirt now too. He put them up there that has that with that quote. Because everybody says that. So now he's like marketing.
Yeah.
That.
And then we went into the, we went into this gym in Malibu and there's all these, you know, big black burly guys, and they saw the t-shirt and said they thought it was a big black cock on the t-shirt.
My trainer.
Yeah.
My trainer. So it was like, he thought it was funny.
Ramming
though.
Speed.
Yeah, and it says ramming, but I mean,
but he thought it was him.
Does the ship have balls?
Yes, it does. Oh, well, on the side. And, you know, it's the head of the spaceship is very.
Swing to the left.
It's very helmet like, and it's got that little eye in the middle.
Well, it's
and
where I mean, the bridge is, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I didn't mean to do this. Honestly,
how do you not mean to do this?
I don't know. I don't know.
Really? You didn't see it?
No, not until somebody pointed it out. I was so proud of the ship. I was like, this is my best spaceship ever, and I was so happy. And then it's oh my god.
What
goodness.
Are the balls? Are the balls the engines? Or
yeah, kind of the cannons and the well, no, the engines are at the rear. So it's kind of the side baffle things. Where they shoot out the missiles that blow up planets.
Well, in Oblivion, Tom Cruise flew around in a big cock and balls. Remember that? That was a total cock and ball spaceship.
Yeah,
yeah.
I mean, that was like... that one actually had a scrotum. And then hair. They had hair on top of that one.
Yeah, that's another reason.
That's it for wind resistance.
So, I mean, and you know, Tracey and I sort of met around the premiere of that, and we got talking, and she read Descent to the Maelstrom, the script, and next minute we're producing it together. We've got a mystery director for that film, which we can't talk about right now. But
we can't talk about a lot.
Yeah, but we sort of cast...
Glad you had you on here.
Now, thanks for coming, guys. Take care. Bye-bye now. That's the Tracey and Neil, everybody.
I know. I mean, it's completely admirable, anybody that's made a feature film, much less 10. I mean, that's pretty damn cool.
Try and do it in 4K and you'll know about suffering. It's really funny too. If you look at, there's this interview with me when I finished the movie, and I was just, I mean, I was fat. I was like Jabba the Hutt, and I look at it, it's like, oh my goodness, I'm so fat. And it's because I was sitting down in a chair for like 12 hours a day, you know, 7 days a week for 3 months. And
stress
I was like,
eating.
Yeah, I was. Yeah. I was. Actually, I was doing potato chips and whiskey a lot.
That'll do it. Yeah. That's not a balanced diet.
There's a country song.
To kill the germs.
Yeah, yeah. I was trying to stay healthy. I was drinking a lot of alcohol to stay healthy. You know?
Right. Right. He really does. Yeah.
No, really, I do. Okay.
He does.
Okay. He's got wheat, right, sometimes.
Well, no, here's the thing. I've done a lot of music videos for famous bands like Manowar and stuff like that. So I've been on tour with all these heavy metal rock bands and, you know...
A lot of germs.
And the problem is, you know, everyone gets sick. You get like a crew of 20 or 50 people and, you know, you're on tour buses. So what I started doing was gargling with vodka. And I swear, I learned this from Russian people. And they don't have medicine in Russia. They have vodka. So you gargle with vodka and it kills all the germs. And that's how I stay healthy when I'm under major stress. You don't swallow. You have to spit.
Only. He'll have this and we'll be like at a convention or something. Only I swallow it.
Yeah, she shouldn't swallow.
It's been like 6 months. I never
so
used to have
I'm
a shot of.
Right now.
Oh God!
This is going to an amazing place.
Oh God!
I'm gonna pull that. I'll pull that clip for future shows.
Yeah. We look like alcoholics, but just trying to stay healthy. That's all it is.
Of course, naturally. Yeah.
Okay, moving on.
Yes, let's move on to this because we ask this of every guest and guest of guests who come on. What is your favorite movie of all time? Well, Tracey, why don't you go first?
Okay. Well, can I give you a favorite, like, triage?
Sure.
Like, I love lots of different genres of movies, but my favorite things to watch are, like, the Hangover movies. I love raunchy guy humor. I really do. And, yeah.
Do you like Revenge of the Nerds? And
I do. I like all that shit, and it's really funny, because people are like, why are you laughing? And I laugh really hard. I mean, I love lots of fantastic movies. I love August Osage County. I love anything Star Wars. I love anything Star Trek. I mean, but it's like, I love raunchy guy movies. Me and my youngest daughter... We'll, like, sit down together. This is a terrible thing to say. And watch them all every time they're on. Hall Pass. I mean, any of them.
Did you dig on the sequels? I didn't think they measured up to the first Hangover.
I loved them.
Yeah, that first Hangover was something else.
And I'm in a really good raunchy comedy that I'm shooting in a few months, which is really, really fun. Yeah.
A lot going on. Tracey,
a lot going on. Do you want to know what it's called? Because I can tell you
sure.
that.
Sure.
Yes, cock and balls.
Please.
Swallow.
It's called, this I can tell you. That's funny with what I'm going to say.
Hello.
Okay, it's called Who's Jenna Jameson?
I know.
Yeah, Lee knows.
Not funny. But it's a comedy. So,
so is it making fun of her?
Well, no, it's just everybody thinks I look like her, but it's lots and lots of raunchy humor.
You do.
That's cool. That's a good thing. I mean, they could say you look like Ron Jeremy.
That's a good point.
Yeah, you know, they could.
That's
maybe
what they
when
say
I
to
do
me.
That.
You don't.
When I do that horror film, right?
When I have my Ron Jeremy hair on half. <well. laughs>
What's your favorite movie of all time, Neil?
I would say The Empire Strikes Back.
Nice.
You're not the first person in 70 shows to say that. But
actually, no. Empire? He might be the first.
No,
most people say Star Wars.
There was one Empire.
Oh, okay.
I bet Audrey Kearns maybe even recently. Someone recently mentioned it.
Yeah.
But that's because it's a great choice.
I can recite any line from Star Wars or Empire Strikes Back.
I could have fun with that.
Here, we'll play a quick clip of it.
Once I get my license tomorrow, kind of.
Oh, that's not it.
That was so not it.
Oh, fuck.
Episode 1.
I was going to play the stupid Mumford thing. Never mind. Go
ahead. No disintegration.
Maybe you could just give us a few lines. It'll be just like he played a little bit of it.
Here,
we'll name a scene.
No disintegration.
Just pick.
Wait.
Make it good. Like
so you're challenging
thing.
Us. We name a scene. You
no,
give
I'm
going to
say, I'm gonna say a line, and then you say the line that comes after, right?
Okay.
Let's
do that.
Ooh.
No disintegration.
Well, there is no line after
that.
See, that's a trick question.
Okay.
That's what he said, Boba Fett.
But he knew the answer.
He says, as you wish.
As you wish. Well, it's just, you
know, oh, okay, wait. I think of another Boba Fett line.
It's like a new game.
A sister. You have a twin sister.
Oh.
And he keeps
but
talking.
That's Return of the Jedi.
Oh, it is Return of the Jedi.
Your thoughts betray her, too.
It's another trick question.
But that's the correct answer, though. They even called me out on that.
Perhaps you feel you're being treated unfairly. Did I say that right? Maybe I didn't. Sorry, we're screwing this up.
You can correct him and then do the next line.
I am altering the deal.
Pray I don't alter it any further.
Got one.
That's an easy one.
Where I said the right one.
It was still awesome.
The steel's getting worse all the time.
There we go. That's what I was going for.
Or anytime Lando says Han.
Han.
Yep.
It's still time to save Han.
Oh, he was being choked.
Give me your favorite Lobot line.
There was no lines. He's dead, by the way.
Did Lobot die?
It's really sad.
He's one of the great first secondary characters that you're like, I wonder what that guy's day is like. You know, like he just kind of shows up for a little bit, and then he obviously has a whole day.
What did Power Droid do before Star Wars?
Yeah.
I just like the fact he was sitting in a room with his eyes closed.
Yeah.
And then, you know, Lando hit this button, and suddenly his eyes open. Oh, I've got to do something.
Yeah.
He's just sitting there in the room.
He has no will. It's kind of creepy.
And one of the great things about Star Wars is that that guy had a whole day before that. He had to go and he had to sit down. But all you ever see is the moment his eyes come on and then he just goes and helps Lando. But he's just been sitting there all day or doing whatever. Yeah.
Well, there is some deleted scenes where you can actually see him running around Cloud City as well doing other stuff.
Oh,
yeah, yeah. It's on the Blu-ray, I think. Or, you know, it does exist. So,
more
you know,
Lobot.
He was doing it. He was just walking around being chased by stormtroopers. So,
Do you think it was because Irvin Kershner directed it that it was so great? The reins were handed off and got fresh eyes on it?
Yeah. I see, Irvin Kershner was really, and I've read the making of books, he was really working with the actors as much as possible, trying to bring out the character. And he actually really contributed a bit to the script as well. They were trying to really change the script so that it was, you know, he made some notes to try to bring the characters alive. And you can see he did alternate takes on, you know, like Han Solo and Princess Leia walking up the ice cavern in Hoth, you know, when they're sort of, you know, Han, blah, 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 and they're arguing with each other. The original version of that is so long, and they're talking about all sorts of things. Mm-hmm. So, you know, a lot of script writing, for me at least, I find is made in the edit room. And when you see the outtakes of Empire Strikes Back, you can see how much extra stuff there was. It's remarkable. You can see what Irvin Kershner cut out, and he made a whole new sequence out of their conversation. The original conversation was going all over the place.
Yeah, too much info.
Yeah, and you know, I think that's the secret with him. He really worked the edit really heavily, and maybe that was George Lucas taking over. I don't know, but it's
and improvised on the set, right? I Love You, I Know, the whole famous Han and Leia.
There's so many improvs, and that's something I learned to do too. Is a lot of improvisation, and that's something Tracey is very excited about too, because you know we've got Descent in the Maelstrom coming out, where we're actually, it's all character stuff. You know, I've done explosion sci-fi stuff, and now we're doing a major time travel character movie with explosions in the background, but it's all about the people. So that's kind of what we're going to, you know, go for is spend more time shooting and doing improv and stuff. And I think that worked with The Empire Strikes Back, is because there is this life to it. You know, it's a reality.
Naturalism.
Yeah. Except when Princess Leia kisses her brother. And the original version was a major smooch on the lips. And, you know, I think they cut that down.
They didn't
down.
Know yet.
No, but, I mean, I love that. You know, I think it's great because, you know, it's, I mean, why wouldn't they?
Yeah.
Know? Well, Empire,
they don't know.
Empire Strikes Back is quite the balancing act, too, because it's a second act movie. I mean, there's really not a whole lot of gigantic plot movements like there is in Star Wars or maybe Jedi, but definitely Star Wars is like a very tight plot, and it's here and it's here and it's here and it's delivering. And that one is just more being with the characters and watching them evolve as people. So, you know, you kind of almost can't have George Lucas's directing style of actors to try and sell that.
Exactly.
I think the same can be said of The Hangover 2, right, Tracy?
Yeah.
Absolutely, absolutely. We're going to talk about a deep movie now.
Yes, The Hangover.
By the way, The Hangover, to jump over to The Hangover, mm-hmm. I have to say, I love that it took this, you know, sort of Revenge of the Nerds type thing, but added this amazing plot storytelling, this reverse storytelling style.
See?
I won't see the third one. I love that they did the same thing in the second one, because it's the only comedy, raunchy comedy, that's ever done this, like, memento storytelling style. Mm-hmm. And so that they didn't do that for the third one. That's like watching John McClane not be trapped in an enclosed space. Like, once he starts running all over the place, you're like, well, what's the point of being a Die Hard movie if you're all over the United States?
Which happened, and that's, like, what audiences said. Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
And you know what else it is with The Hangover, since they do have the plot? You can't stop watching it. Like, if you're watching it, you can't, like, run to the bathroom or something, because you'll miss something. Like, something really, really funny.
It's like a tight plot.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you would discover everything they were up to as they do. It's great. Yeah, that is a funny movie.
There you go.
Am I stating the obvious? But when you watch that the second time, you realize if you were paying attention the first time, you figure it out in the first 5 minutes. Hey, his mattress is missing. They walk right outside and go, hey, there's a mattress on the roof. And then the next hour and a half, we're wondering where this guy is.
See, and I love that it's so random, too. I love randomness.
Yeah,
any sort of random comedy.
Yeah, Galifianakis says, what's his name, Brad, Steve, Mike?
Who? Justin Bartha?
The other one?
The other one?
The other one.
Hey, the other one's gone, and his mattress is missing. Movie's over.
All right, before we get to what did you see this week, I want to ask quickly, because we mentioned this concept earlier in the show. Do you guys have a movie that puts you in movie jail, a classic that you've never seen?
I can't think of a classic, because
I haven't seen Vertigo. Like, that's
mine. Oh my God, I just watched Vertigo again like 6 months ago. I've watched that movie so many times, like every year I watch that.
Holds up?
Pardon?
Holds up?
Holds up.
Yeah.
I have recent movies that put me in movie jail, like even when with nominating and stuff, like 12 Years a Slave. I haven't sat down and watched that. I mean, we're supposed to watch all of these movies.
This is one of the funny things about movie jails, because we can go, no, you're not in movie jail for that. Like, well, you could just decide, like, you're fine not seeing that.
With all the awards and everything,
that's movie home,
I'd like the handcuffs,
home,
please.
You know, jail.
Let me put this to you, Adam. The one I haven't seen is Top Gun. Is that movie jail?
Oh, yeah. Wow.
I think so.
I don't think so.
No?
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes. See?
Val Kilmer.
I'm getting a little...
But I don't know if we get to vote.
Sure, if you're saying yes to me, I agree.
We do.
Yeah, sure.
If you agree with me, you get to vote.
Beverly Hills Cop, movie jail.
I've seen it.
Okay.
Everybody's seen it.
Just thinking of Simpson Bruckheimer that you need to
I do. Like all movies that have the Pointer Sisters singing in it.
Well,
so.
Everybody. Right? Yeah, it's going to sell a movie.
Who doesn't?
Well, I haven't seen this movie, True Believer.
Yeah, what is this? Back in the poster on our wall.
It's got Robert Downey Jr. It's Robert Downey Jr. Love Fest on the wall.
I haven't seen it either.
True Believer and Air America.
Air America on the wall here?
Just for a moment, Paul, if you could read the little catchphrase there, I think it says everything between RDJ and Mel Gibson.
Air America, the few, the proud, the totally insane.
Yeah!
Wow. But they've been huge supporters of one another, apparently. Robert Downey Jr. was on Howard Stern this week talking about how, well, we all know that Robert Downey was one of the first guys to write a big letter to Hollywood saying forgive Mel Gibson. It's because, I guess, when Robert Downey was in his big drug state, Mel was there for him.
I think right here, Air America was
because
Robert Downey Jr.'s big meltdown.
There's a lot of forgiveness out there.
Yeah.
I nearly drove over Mel Gibson once. I was living in Sherman Oaks, and he was walking the street with his wife. I get that girl, that crazy woman who recorded him.
Oh, so not Robin.
No, not. I mean, the second wife, you know.
Yeah.
And then they were walking the street with I think they had a baby or something. And he just walked out in front of me, and I nearly ran him over, which is really strange. Yeah, you know, in the middle of the day, they were going for a walk.
I thought it was weird that he would be in Sherman Oaks.
Yeah, well, he'd be in Malibu or something.
Right. Exactly. Right.
No, but he would go down to the local. They were living in the Sherman Oaks Hills.
Oh, okay.
And he would go to the local bar and get drunk. There's all those photos of him. You know, that's where he'd go and drink. And
you know where he drank in Malibu, where he got caught all the time, was Moonshadows.
Oh, he was a Moonshadows boy.
He was a Moonshadows boy. Yeah,
I've been caught
his whole
too.
Family still lives there.
I've been caught there.
You were caught there with me. Yeah.
What does the table think of Iron Man 4, starring Robert Downey Jr., written by Shane Black and directed by Mel Gibson? This is on the table for consideration.
Amazing, right?
One of the great things
that you could possibly imagine happening. First of all, Marvel doesn't like to pay anybody any money. Who do you have to pay less money than Mel Gibson to be in a prestige project right now? Is he going to direct the shit out of it? It's Mel Gibson. Yes. Thank you. Iron Man 4, directed by Mel Gibson.
And there'll be a torture scene in it for sure.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, written by Shane Black. Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah, that would be the best.
And then make him the bad guy. He plays bad guys now.
Now he can play a bad guy because we buy it.
He had to become a bad guy to play him. But anyway.
Before we go into what did you see this week, Tracy, you appeared also on Family Ties.
Yes, I did.
Many, many moons ago.
How cool was that?
Very, very young. Cool. Very, very, very young, yeah.
But
yeah.
You already knew the show before you showed up on it, right? You, like, knew it as a show?
Yeah. I did. I knew it, yeah.
So you're walking onto this set.
That must have been intimidating.
You know, that was back when your heart still raced when you walked on a set. You didn't show it, but your heart still raced.
Yeah.
So that was pretty exciting because you're familiar with all the people and things like that. But then they just treat you just like, you know... It's like your family, makes it so easy.
Did you have interactions with everybody in the cast? Were you like in a scene with like Michael J. Fox?
Or Michael Gray?
Yeah.
Didn't you make out with Michael J. Fox?
I did not make out with Michael J. Fox.
Oh, no, that's something on Different Strokes.
Movie Guys
hey,
exclusive.
Hey.
You're on Different Strokes as well?
It was after hours.
You're very funny.
Were you on Different Strokes? Did you get to be on the one with Tootie? Facts of Life?
A Tootie, that is so funny.
Right?
Yeah, I know. Can you believe we watched Facts of Life looking back on it?
Right?
Like, what were we thinking?
Like, I never missed Facts of Life. How stupid is that?
I was embarrassed that I watched it, but I was like a closet junkie, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you take the good and you take the bad.
Yeah. You take them both. And there you have.
Did you really were on Different Strokes, weren't you?
I really was, yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Shut up.
Never missed that show either.
Oh, I watched that.
Yeah.
My friend used to be the stand-in for Arnold because he was always getting his dialysis. And so he couldn't be on the set when they would do blocking rehearsals and stuff. And so she would do that and then go and tell him his blocking when he was doing his dialysis.
Wow. That was
Yeah, Robin, who I did Nonsense with.
Right. Now, how old were you when you were on the sets of Facts of Life?
Three.
She was a child.
I started at two. No,
she was a baby twin.
I'd really, like, I was young. I was very young. Yeah.
What a fun playground.
Yeah, it was a fun playground.
No comment is a perfectly acceptable answer.
Yeah.
It may not be an acceptable question, Adam.
Oh, sorry.
All right, let's play another
round. Just curious
if
you're making out like a fox.
What did you see this week?
All right, what did you see this week? Table? Did you see anything cool? I can tell you we did. Karen and I went to see Gone Girl.
Oh,
I want to see that.
Oh, my gosh.
And David Fincher's a genius still?
Yes. Fantastic.
David Fincher, one of the premier directors of our time. Make sure you see everything he does.
Lee, right? I will tell you, this is an inside joke thing. Lee, I will tell you, it is not the movie you think it's going to be, which makes it even better.
Thank God, I want to see it now.
Yes, that trailer.
It's good.
Is,
that's a great trailer.
I don't know who lobbied to make that trailer. Probably Fincher. Brilliant. You know, because I bet she has a kind of pull to say,
oh, yeah.
Let's only give away so much information about this movie, because there's a whole new world of the film that you are not privy to.
So we're just seeing like the first act in that trailer, aren't we?
Half an act, maybe.
Yeah, I might even say.
Shit, it's good.
Sweet.
That story.
I love when you're in a movie and you go, that's everything I've seen in the trailer, and we're only a half hour into this movie.
There's a neat thing. I don't want to give anything away, so I'll be careful. There's a neat thing about time in this movie, because a lot of stuff happens, and then a little title card will come up and say, day two, missing. And you're like, holy shit, all that stuff happened in 2 days.
Yeah.
Wow. Lots of stuff happens.
And a little The Shining vibe, right? Occasionally a title comes up. Is that kind of...
Oh, no, it creeps down the bottom left-hand
just
corner.
So that you can see where they are in, like, her being missing and this and that. It gives you a timeline. And you just realize how, you know, when someone's missing, like whenever that little girl was missing, I can't remember her name, the one who played the violin or the cello, whatever. To us, we go about our lives and time goes by. But for them, they're consumed with it. Yes. So much happens in the first day the person's missing. It's just because their whole life has stopped. It's so neat.
And actresses on parade in that movie. Kim Dickens is fantastic. Rosamund Pike in the lead is awesome.
She's great. Oh, my God.
Yeah. And then, they're two.
What a wonderful role, too, for a woman. Great part.
And not to slight Affleck, who's also very good in the movie. Yeah. I mean, it's Fincher. It's great.
Did they find out who killed Laura Palmer?
You know what? They turned on the fan at the top of the stairs.
You know that's coming
creepy
back, too.
Creepy guy came out.
Oh, my God. Twin Peaks returns. That's
very exciting.
We also saw The Equalizer.
Oh,
and that is
so
a movie
bad.
You think it's going to be, and it totally delivers.
Perfect.
Yeah. That movie's everything you expect, Adam.
Oh.
Guy walking away from an explosion in slow motion.
Yes, check.
Check with the biggest explosion.
No, the biggest Boston has ever seen. It's a huge explosion. I mean, does he have a particular set of skills? Yes.
Yes.
Does he have
a
routine the way he eats and moves everything around the same way every time? Until it's disrupted.
I love that shit.
Someone young he's got to protect? Check.
Check.
It's all there.
Is everything else
he
good?
He gets pulled back in.
Doesn't matter.
He gets pulled back in.
He was out.
Pull back in.
And it has a fantastic ending, very, very ending.
Ooh.
Yeah.
So you leave satisfied.
It's so good.
Lee, you want to go see this one with me?
It's really good.
I do have a question, though. Yeah. Does it start out with him kicking ass? And does he continue to kick ass?
Oh, I think he's out of the game at the beginning. He's out.
It's a slow draw into kicking ass.
You know what?
But you don't realize who he is at first.
No,
right?
Because he's such a good guy. At one point, he almost made me cry at the beginning.
That's true.
Because he's helping one of these guys who he works with at like a minimum wage job to lose weight so he can get a better job as a security guard.
Mm.
So he helps him with his diet and his workout. And I'm like,
here's a straight and noble guy. I wonder if he has a history of being a killer.
In a fight, who would win? Equalizer or Jack Reacher?
Oh,
Good question.
Equalizer.
It depends on whether or not you're using guns or things that are found objects.
But that's the cool thing, yeah.
Hand to hand?
Jack Reacher doesn't use many guns either, does he?
That's true. He doesn't use a gun at all, does he?
I need to let guest of guest know you answered incorrectly.
Top Gun wins.
Lee is our Tom Cruise apologist.
I agree.
He has yet to find a Tom Cruise movie he can't apologize. He refused to apologize for.
I will say one more thing that you won't get until you see the movie. He does eventually use a gun.
Yes.
I'm excited to see this. Speaking of The Equalizer, Paul and I sat down and watched 3 Days to Kill, which is Kevin Costner doing awesome Equalizer shit.
Yeah. It's all the things you want from a Luc Besson produced movie.
Yeah, showrunner Luc Besson. Way better than director Luc Besson at this point.
Yeah. That is true. 3 Days to Kill is better than The Family. Both tried to be funny and have action. 3 Days to Kill does it better.
Do you think Karen would like 3 Days to Kill? Because there's so much funny personality,
you know what?
things in it.
I'd love The Equalizer, and you and I can agree on those kind of movies, so I'd probably like it.
You would, I think.
And
you would
I like Kevin
it.
Costner.
And this one has, 3 Days to Kill has a lot more personality than like Shooting and Chasing. Shooting and Chasing is like maybe 15% of the movie, but the personality stuff is really good. There's just, I mean, there's a whole bunch of characters that populate it that he ends up dealing with, and he's always trying to, you know the shot from the trailer where he hears the bumping in the trunk, he's trying to relate to his daughter, he goes back and he goes, I'm trying to have a conversation with my daughter and slams the trunk on a guy. There's just a bunch of stuff like that. She puts this ringtone on his phone. It becomes a running joke. Like, what's that pop song? I don't care. Whatever that. She puts that ringtone so when she calls, he knows. So he'll be in the middle of tying a guy up in the shower, about to put like electrical things on his nipples, and then just this ringtone comes in and he goes, hold on a second, I have to get this. Hi, honey. You know, it's a lot of moments like that.
Somehow Mick G directed scenes like that, to where they're not goofy funny, but they just kind of play real funny. And I'm impressed by that, considering I could give or take Mick G.
Well, Charlie's Angels is good Mick G, but I can't get a beat on what Mick G is when you look at the breadth of his career.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I like Charlie's Angels-ish, you know?
And it's a relatively bloodless movie as well. And the bad guys, see, one of the things that's hard to watch about Equalizer is the bad guys are, like, ruthless, and they kill whores and stuff, and they're kind of nasty and bloody.
It's bloody.
The ones in 3 Days to Kill are just like evil bad guys you've heard of, he's just got to get them. But they don't spend the movie showing you how bad they are by having them do a bunch of bloody killing.
But this is the greatest thing. The first 5 minutes of the movie is like the greatest. There's just this monologue that this CIA person who's informing us, but somebody in the room supposedly too, about everything that we're going to need to know, and then just get out of the way. Like it's such a get it out of the way conversation. It's like, this man is called the Wolf. He's dealing with this man, the albino. Like, I mean, seriously, they're called the Wolf,
totally
the albino, the accountant. Are the people they're looking for. And so, like, and then it's like, so he goes off, he tries to become a father to his daughter, something interrupts it, and he's got to go get the Wolf. And then he's got to go get the accountant. And it's just like, it's so funny. I love it.
And it's great Costner, understated, charming, funny. You know,
Costner being awesome.
Yeah, it's good.
And kicking ass.
So, and then you want to say a few words about The Good Lie?
And we saw The Good Lie, and it surprised the crap out of me because I thought, oh, cute Reese Witherspoon movie. And it starts out in Sudan. So it's in Africa.
Like any Reese Witherspoon movie.
Exactly. So I know that Reese Witherspoon's going to show up. And I'm like, oh, when she shows up, it's going to be weird, right? So they're in the Sudan, and they're in trees climbing, and they're getting attacked by militias and stuff. And the kids are all running and taking care of themselves. And they're fantastic kid actors, by the way.
Continuing
fantastic.
The streak of good child actors lately.
But
normally I don't like to see them, but they've been great lately.
The good news is Reese Witherspoon does not show up. Until they get back to Minneapolis or somewhere?
Kansas City.
Then when she shows up, it's fine because now we're in her world. But boy, she's great. And the movie, again, a crier. Oh my gosh, about family and history of where you've come from. And
The Good Lie, what's the title?
Pre-9/11, the Sudanese Huckleberry refugees Finn. Would be taken in to America and just put to work in places just to get them the
McDonald's,
fuck out of there.
Yeah,
this is right before 9/11 and when they were still taking people in.
They stopped doing
and
it.
Then this happened, and then that's part of the problem is they couldn't do something else. But The Good Lie comes from the idea of Huckleberry Finn, where he lies and says that Jim is his slave because he isn't his slave. But by that point in the book, Huckleberry Finn learns that sometimes you have to lie for the right reasons.
I gotcha.
And that sort of happens in this. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. That theme runs later in the film. And it's full of good actors you've never heard of who at the end of the movie you find out are all either Sudanese refugees themselves or descendants of.
Yeah.
And so they're not actors who are doing great, subtle work. And you got to buy into one big concept, though. You're dealing with bodies floating in a river and helicopters coming in and just shooting up African villages. And then suddenly we're in Kansas City doing a little fish out of water stuff with the Sudanese. Yeah. Don't know what an escalator is.
What is McDonald's?
But if you can just buy into that, the heart's in the right place of this movie, and it's pretty entertaining.
And Reese Witherspoon doesn't ruin it.
No, she's got an Oscar. She can do it when
she
needs to.
What'd she get an Oscar for?
Walk the Line.
Yeah, that was really, she was great in that.
Mm-hmm. All right, Karen, since you're talking, let's have Karen give her a weekly look at the birthdays of those who make the movies. Karen's birthdays, take it away.
All right, let's start off our week of birthdays by wishing a very happy birthday to Artie Lang, who turns 46 despite his best efforts.
Oh, well put.
Next up, let's wish a happy birthday to Miss Joan Cusack, who turns 51 but can play anywhere from everyone's best friend to everyone's mom. We all know Joan from her work in Working Girl and In and Out, both Oscar-nominated for Best Supporting Actress in a Role, and is a voice of Jessie in the Toy Story movies. But, I ask you, what roles did Miss Cusack turn down? So I'm going to tell you the role that she turned down and see if you can name the actress for me that actually went on to get the role. All right, in The Accused, she turned down the role of Sarah Tobias.
I'll
the
guess.
Best friend in The Accused?
Kelly McGillis? No. She wouldn't take on that big part.
It was Jodie Foster. It was a big part.
What? Oh, yeah. The big role?
The big role.
Joan Cusack?
Yes, but she couldn't do it for some reason. Gangs of New York. The
Cameron Diaz part.
Yeah.
Wow, that would be
But that one is interesting because she was offered that when she was younger, but it took 20 years to make the movie.
So eventually
she out-aged it, sadly. Pulp
Rake's
Fiction.
Victim in horror so far. Yeah. All right.
Pulp Fiction.
Oh.
I don't want to give you the name of the character because you'll know right away.
The girl with the shit in her face?
Uh-uh. You would think... You
Who's
would
that?
Think...
What's that line? Is that the girl with the shit all,
oh,
all
yeah.
the shit all
was
over
it
her
Anarchette?
Face?
No.
It was Anarchette?
No.
That's Bonnie. That's my wife.
She actually was Mia.
Oh, so Mia Uma Thurman's
Wall.
Character.
So, yeah, so wow. Some of these are really big parts.
They are.
Apparently, she
Joan Cusack never gets big
quirky
parts.
Quirky best friend,
it's
apparently.
So weird that she's up for them.
And this is a quirky best friend kind of thing. The part of Bobby in The Stepford Wives, she had that role, but then her mother got sick and she had to leave, so it went to... Not a huge part.
Kathina Jimmy?
No, you'd think. That'd be good. Ms. Bette Midler.
Oh, Bette Midler, right.
Yeah,
right.
But I remember that character be very beautiful. Her whole point was that she was super beautiful, so... Apparently, she's helping herself play the awkward friend by not taking all these leads.
A friend of mine in Chicago got rear-ended by Joan Cusack. She got rear-ended in her car and gets out. And who gets out of the other car but Joan? It's Becky Eldridge.
Shut up.
Got rear-ended by Joan Cusack.
Was she
colliding?
Literally. Was she cool?
Yeah, I mean, as cool as you can be, here's some information. Okay, I got to get on with my day because I'm obviously in a hurry and I'm Joan Cusack. And I just rear-ended your car.
This has nothing to do with birthdays or Joan Cusack, but I do want to say that Dennis Quaid, he came upon an accident scene when my friend was in it and was a super awesome guy about it. My
Sweet.
Friend was in an intersection, got sideswiped. That car went wherever. She passed out when she came to in the middle of the intersection in her the bag. She looks up and she's like, I must be dead. Because there's Dennis Quaid.
I would think that. I mean, I'm a very heterosexual man, but I would love to. If I ever have an accident, I would want Dennis Quaid to be there when I came to.
And he was like, all right, sweetheart, how are you? Okay, here. And he was
so. He just seemed to be in control.
He was so amazing. I would be staring at his veiny, amazing arms. But he was so amazing that she remembers him just saying, I've called 911. I'll stay with you until they get here. Now it's important that you tell me if you have anything valuable in the car, like your phone, your computer. I'm going to put that all in the ambulance with you so no one steals it. He got her purse, her computer, all that. He didn't take it. He put it in the ambulance with her.
And then she said what I would say. Hey, you were in Jaws 3.
All right, moving on to our
I thought I might have been DOA.
Our last birthday for today is for Mr. Daryl Hall, who turned 67, but could play anywhere from that tall
Jesus
blonde guy.
Jesus Christ, 67?
I know.
Daryl Hall?
Daryl Hall.
Damn.
I believe that of Oates.
He can play anywhere from the tall blonde one to that guy with Lyme disease. All right, so I have a game for you. I'm going to give you four movie titles. All right, four movie titles. And you're going to tell me which movie did not have a Hall & Oates song in it.
Ooh, I like this.
And for fun, I will, after you guessed, I'll tell you what song.
We've been talking a lot. Throw this to the guests.
All right. All right, guests, here we go.
Thanks, Tracy. I'm going to give you the answer right here.
Tracy, we know a lot about movies.
I don't know if you guessed that.
Now, here are the four movies. Which one does not have a Hall & Oates song in it?
Awesome.
I have a feeling you're going to do very good with this. All right, Better Off Dead.
Because we're on the same team.
Yeah. All right, Better Off Dead, The Breakfast Club, Earth Girls Are Easy, and She's Out of My League.
She's Out of My League.
That's what you'd think.
No, you wouldn't think.
I bet you I know.
Well, number one?
Well, you might think that. No, and She's Out of My League, they have Every Time You Go Away, and Your Kiss is on my list.
Oh, that's.
I know, right? Oh. Who would think?
And Every Time You Go Away is also in Breakfast Club, right?
Yeah.
No, that's
a trick question. I knew it.
Is that 16 Candles?
You didn't know it or you would have said it.
I knew it was going to be that.
Let's play 20 Trains and Automobiles.
I did that on purpose.
Damn it.
Good, you fell for it.
You know
nice,
what?
Nice, I knew you'd know that.
I knew it was Breakfast Club at first, and then when you said that, I was like, no, wait, that's in Breakfast Club.
Wait until the second question.
All right.
Uh-oh. Oh, you've already looked?
I've seen the...
Yeah. Okay.
You got some answers coming your way.
All right, the next group of movies.
Tracy Birdsall's cheating.
Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
I was looking at the script.
The Wedding Singer. Night and Day. And Top Gun.
Oh my God, I hated Night and Day.
Which I brought up earlier. Oh, did you?
I hated that movie.
Oh my God.
That was like one of the worst movies I've ever seen.
Which one?
Am I in trouble?
No.
I mean, like, really, really hated it.
You probably did, and I promise you, you didn't hate it because of Tom Cruise. He's not the reason you hate anything.
I hated it because nothing was believable in the whole thing.
Oh, not well.
I feel like I'm watching a play. You know, it's like the special effects were bad, the sets were bad.
Now we're talking Night and Day, right?
Yeah.
All right. I gotta tell you, there's a thing I call the Batman and Robin rule. That is to say, once Batman slides down the dinosaur's neck at the very beginning and says, "Hiya, freeze, I'm Batman," that movie doesn't owe you anything because it's already set that there are no rules. Now, I would say that Night and Day starts once he takes out all those guys on the plane completely improbably and then lands a jet in a cornfield, the movie doesn't owe you anything for the rest of it because it's already set where its boundaries are.
It
you know?
It's so corny right there.
But that's the beginning.
You're doing great, June.
I know, but I was already over it by then, and I had to sit through it.
I
but
know.
Anyway.
See, you couldn't decide to turn it off, right?
Doing good, June.
No,
see?
I
see.
No,
yeah. All right, here we go.
Tracy's last appearance on our
show. Hey! All right, so I have to bring back another guest. Remember?
Right.
Oh, that's right.
Bring a guest of a guest.
Watch it.
All right. So again, they are Planes. Which one does not? Have a.
I know the answer.
Hold on. Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, The Wedding Singer, Night and Day, or Top Gun. Any guesses?
I do.
I have a guess.
Guys, you guys have a guess?
I'll provide the ticking. Tick, tick,
I think
tick,
because
tick.
I think Wedding Singer is your goof in there because it's full of 80s music, but I don't think there's a Hall & Oates song in that.
I'm so good at this, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Nope.
No?
They have You Make My Dreams. You Make My Dreams Come True. Yes.
Top Gun, right? Because you'd think.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah. No, you
I'm
cannot do a gay
you.
Volleyball
scene. Oh, wait, you know what confused me there? You know what confused me there? They sing, don't they sing You've Lost That Love and Feeling? Which they covered.
Right.
All in all, it's covered. And I got confused.
Yeah, I knew that.
I worked very hard on this. All right, lastly. So here's our list of four. Which one does not have Hall & Oates? Okay. St. Elmo's Fire, Bad Teacher, The Fighter, and Ruthless People. Again, St. Elmo's Fire, Bad Teacher, The Fighter.
See, St. Elmo's Fire, you'd think
people.
It would, right?
Yeah, I see that.
You'd think it would.
But she's good at trick questions.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah.
Now it's a double trick, so.
It's a double trick. This is a tricky one.
Ruthless People obviously would have it in there, I think.
Well, see,
that just seemed to go for
that. That would be my first guess.
Would it be?
Yeah.
Okay, I would think that one obviously.
Neil, take a guess.
I'm going to say Ruthless People.
And that's what I wanted you to do.
She is evil. Karen is evil.
She's a ruthless person.
That's right. When it comes to my quizzes. Nope. But the thing that's kind of fun is out of the three that are left, St. Elmo's Fire, Bad Teacher, and The Fighter, it's the same song in two of the movies.
Ooh.
Ah. Sarah, smile.
Now, I would say, obviously, you would say, The Fighter, it can't be in that.
No,
so it's
it
in
is.
That.
Yeah, okay.
Exactly. Now you're thinking like me.
And you'd say, St. Elmo's Fire, obviously it's in that. So it isn't.
So it isn't.
So it's
St. Elmo's Fire. Okay, it's not in there. All right. So, and Lee, you know how much I love to hear celebrities sing.
People ask me all the time, tell me two things about Karen. One, loves deep throat. Two, loves when celebrities sing.
I concur.
Oh my God. All right.
On the second part.
Calling back to her, you gotta swallow thing. Okay.
Oh, thank you very much.
Please, from your diaphragm, Karen, let's go.
I would like us all to listen to the lovely singing styling of my favorite song from Runaway Bride, A Little Man-Eater from Hall & Oates.
Deep throat!
Everybody.
There are so many great movies I love that have Hall & Oates music in them.
WNBC.
All right, well, that wraps another Movie Showcast, everybody. Follow us on Twitter at TheMovieGuys, on Facebook.com/TheMovieGuys, as well as on YouTube, iTunes, SoundCloud, Vine, Instagram, all that shit. Thanks to Tracey Birdsall.
Yeah.
Again, go to dawnofthecrescentmoon.com. And what's your Twitter handle?
Oh, Tracey Birdsall 1.
At Tracey Birdsall 1.
That's me, though. That's my Twitter handle. I don't know their Twitter handle.
You what?
Oh, I don't know their Twitter.
No, that'll all come down the pike. And if you go to the website,
we'll just follow you and you'll tell us.
We'll do that.
And special thanks to Neil Johnson.
Yay!
You can find Starship Rising right now in your Walmart or your iTunes. And what else you got to plug? You got a website, production company website?
Yeah,
or something like that?
www.empire.com. empire.com.
Named his production company after Empire Strikes
After
Back.
His favorite movie.
That's nice. Yeah.
Right now, Neil, I feel like I could take on the whole empire myself. I know what you mean. Thank you.
Well said. And we'll be thanks also to Steve Scholes for his writing contributions to the show every week.
Hi,
and remember,
Steve.
You can find everything we're up to at themovieguys.net. We'll be back next week with a lot of movies to cover. There's Fury, The Book of Life, Men, Women, and Children, Kill the Messenger, Birdman. We don't know what we're going to do to cover
Nick
them
Fury
all.
Story.
But we'll do everything that we can, and we'll see you then. Watch out, boy. She'll chew you up.
Boy, here she comes. She's a deep throater.
That's right. Boy, here she comes. She's a man-eater, all right.